Welcome to lab two. In this lab, we're going to use a temperature-sensitive resistor, or a thermistor, to measure the temperature of some cooling boiling water. So we have boiling water, we have the container, and you'll take your temperature sensor. You're going to add about 60 milliliters of this boiling water to the cup, and then we're going to wait for 3 minutes, and then after the 3 minutes, we're going to add this ice water to the same cup, and then we'll wait for another 3 minutes. Of course, before we do all that, we have to build the circuit. And let's just remind ourselves, we're trying to measure temperature as a function of time for this water, and we're going to use a thermistor as our sensor to do that. And just as a general idea, remember what we're doing is we're sensing data, and we're going to use our instrumentation and some mathematics to get to our measured goal. And the instrumentation in this case is pretty much what we've been using before. It's the voltage divider. And our voltage divider circuit, you recall, has two resistors and a Vout. And our design choice here is to basically replace one of these resistors with our variable resistor or thermistor. And then we have to basically determine the other resistor, and I'll talk a little more about how we might go about doing that. So we're going to replace one of these resistors with the thermistor. The output from this instrumentation is going to be, as usual, voltage, or V out, as a function of time, and we know that initially we're going to have some measurement, and then it's going to jump once we add the ice water to it. And again, this might not be how your voltage looks. It might depend on it will totally depend on where you put the sensor, the top or the bottom of that voltage divider. Okay, but let's just say that this is approximately what you get. And the instrumentation, we know from this voltage divider, we can create a relationship between the V out and the resistance of the thermistor, which is going to be one of the resistors in this voltage divider. So the V out is a function of the thermistor resistance, which again is changing with time. But that is the value on this x-axis here, the thermistor resistance. And then on the y-axis is V out here. Now, to get to our desired quantity, we need to convert that Vout value to a temperature value. And we do that by using the transfer function of the thermistor. And that is provided in the documentation. So I'm just going to add some curves here. These may or may not be right. I'm just trying to illustrate, for example, that we take the data point in one domain, in the voltage time domain, and we convert it through the voltage resistance domain and then the temperature resistance domain to get to the temperature time domain. So again, all we're doing here is using the instrumentation and mathematics, which we will have a function temperature versus thermistor resistance and V out versus thermistor resistance. And we take the voltage, we convert it to, we basically convert it from voltage out to resistance, from resistance to temperature, and then back into the temperature versus time domain. And that will give us our graph. Okay, this next part is really for those who might want a more in-depth discussion about designing the circuit. Otherwise, I think you have enough to get started. It's up to you. So in the circuit design, you recall that what we're doing here is we're using the thermistor inside of this voltage divider. And you have a choice of either replacing R1 with the thermistor or R2 with the thermistor. And I'll leave that choice up to you. But once you've made that choice, and it does have implications, you'll have to take the next move, which is to choose the value of the resistor. Now, there's lots of ways that you might go about doing this. One way, you can just experiment. You can just ask somebody. Or you could begin to ask yourself, well, what kind of impact might it have? And one way you might want to do this is to look at how V out changes with different choices for R1 or R2. So I'm just going to presume a configuration. Let's say we put the thermistor at the top. Okay, here's our circuit diagram, and we know that the V out is a function of the V in, and just kind of as a reminder of how we normally draw it, we see that this bottom resistor is the one that we're trying to choose. So the V in, we know, multiplied by this bottom resistor as a fraction of the total resistance will equal our V out. Okay, one way of approaching this is to imagine that you choose an R that's way, way bigger than RT. What happens to V out? And then you might also ask yourself in the other extreme, what if the R was a lot smaller than RT? What happens then to V out? Now, remember, your RT is going to be changing as well because it's going to change with temperature. So a way you could approach this is to do something with math and find out what the sweet spot might be. Okay, so I'm using an online calculator called Desmos, and right away I'm going to set my x and y axis to look at the range I want to see. So the x axis is the thermistor resistance, and the y axis is going to be the V out, and we know the ranges that those are going to take on. And what I'll do here is set up the V out equal to be 5 volts. I'm going to have 5 volts input. And then I'm going to use A as an example of the resistor that I'm going to choose. I don't know what it's going to be, but what I could see is that if I, go from like 1 to a 10 to the 6th ohm resistor, this is what the output will look like. I'm going to set the X value to 1,000 ohms, knowing that at room temperature, I'm going to have about 1,000 ohms. And so this green line represents the reading for my thermistor when we're at room temperature. And you could see that anything beyond a few thousand ohms crunches the measurement up close to 5 volts. So I put another line on here. This purple line represents what it would be like at the hottest temperature, the highest temperature reading. And you could see that I can make use of my V out range when the resistance is lower. In fact, if I set the range of the A value just from 1 to 1,000, you could see that for most of that, I make use of the full measurement range. But at some places, I kind of don't make use of it, like at the extremes. So this is a way that you can figure out how to choose a value for R that will make use of your measurement range.